Shalom uberajá, ¿cómo les va? Buena semana para todos. Shavu atov para todos. Muy buena semana. Como adición en suma al video anterior que había hecho sobre el tema de las brujerías y todas las consecuencias que lleva la práctica con las coronas de abajo, y teniendo en cuenta las cosas que están sucediendo, por ejemplo acá en Argentina, de las que puedo hablar porque estoy viviendo acá, más abiertamente y dar mi opinión más abiertamente, han pasado cosas terribles. Sabemos que existen y ya en este tiempo de los talones, previo, estamos en la previa al momento del mesiánico, del Mashiach, del cambio de era, y por eso el mal está dando manotazos de ahogado de una manera tremenda. Y sabemos muy bien todas las cosas y las bajezas que se están cometiendo. No solo en Europa, en Oriente, en Medio Oriente y en América y en Occidente, sino prácticamente en todo el mundo. Y una de las grandes bajezas y grandes pecados que se están cometiendo, alguna vez un jajam dijo, cualquiera que le haga daño, y estoy de acuerdo con eso, cualquiera que le haga daño a un niño, más vale que se ate una piedra de molino y se eche al río. Le hubiese convenido no haber nacido, ¿no? Textualmente dijo eso. Teniendo en cuenta que para Hashem hacerle daño a un niño es un gran pecado. Es el colmo de la extrema maldad, ¿no? Y lamentablemente estamos viendo. Hace un año se estrenó una película financiada por gente que estuvo en Hollywood, donde muestra una problemática de la trata de personas, no solo la trata de personas que sabemos que ya existe, llamada trata de blancas, el tema que alimenta la prostitución y todo eso, que tiene que ver mucho con secuestros. Está repartido porque hay mucha gente que va y participa de eso voluntariamente, y hay otros que son secuestrados para esos fines, en contra de su voluntad, obviamente. Mujeres que son secuestradas para eso en varios puntos del mundo. Hay organizaciones que están armadas y que proveen y difunden toda esa porquería. Y lo que es peor, nos enteramos con esta película que también hay tráfico de niños para diversos fines, ¿no? Para diversos fines. No solo sacrificios humanos, no solo alimentarse, y no es una teoría conspirativa porque realmente eso sabemos los que hemos investigado a fondo que eso sucede, y de hecho hay gente que lo ha gritado a los cuatro vientos. Entonces estamos viendo que la maldad está en un punto crítico. Están haciendo cosas en donde han perdido prácticamente todos los códigos. Se están mostrando tal como son. Porque, no sé, hace más de 50 años atrás, al menos, de 40, 50 años atrás, había pasado muchísimas cosas malas, pero había límites, había cosas que no se producían. Y vemos con mucha tristeza que lamentablemente ahora está pasando todo esto. Está pasando en todo el mundo, con la connivencia de gobiernos, de políticos. No hay una acción directa contra estas mafias, contra estos degenerados, contra estos demonios, porque esto es llevado a cabo por gente que son demonios en la tierra, prácticamente están completamente tomados por demonios para hacer ese tipo de cosas. Y bueno, el mal está multiplicado con muchas creces, dándonos a entender que estamos viviendo los últimos tiempos previos al milenio de paz y de Teshuvá, ¿no? Entonces, hay que hacer recordar que existe, en base a todo esto, a toda esta gente que practica todas estas cosas, de que existe el Geinom. Muchos lo toman, lo enseñan. He visto artículos de hasta de rabinos que lo toman como un mito. Pero a continuación de este video yo voy a poner un extracto de del rabí. Voy a poner la fuente acá abajo, no me acuerdo. No, bueno, hay un rabí que financió, hizo estos cortos, estas películas, explicando, y está muy didáctico porque cita las fuentes. Son muchísimas las fuentes que mencionan, desde el profeta Isaías hasta escritos del rabí Meir, hasta menciones en los escritos del Tanaj, menciones en el Zohar HaKadosh, obviamente. Entonces, y para sumar a todo eso, contarles mi experiencia personal. Ustedes saben que yo tuve experiencias místicas desde mucho antes de llegar a la Kabbalah. Pero ya estando dentro del estudio de la Kabbalah, del judaísmo, ya cuando me convertí finalmente al judaísmo, una de las cosas que se me mostraron, pude ver muchas cosas, y de hecho puedo atestiguar, de hecho participo y participé en la televisión mundial en cuanto al tema ovni extraterrestre, que es una realidad que ya no se puede negar. Y ya les expliqué lo que queda más que claro, que hay de todo dentro de lo que es el mundo de la creación. Están las tres columnas dentro de lo que es todo el mundo de lo que se llaman extraterrestres. Y puedo fundamentar con videos y con experiencias todas esas experiencias. Y no solo eso, porque también tuve experiencias místicas del tipo de visiones, visiones acompañados, visiones con testigos al lado mío que pueden dar fe de las cosas que vimos y escuchamos, visiones de seres superiores, de Sadikim. Hemos visto Sadikim, seres superiores. He recibido mensajes muchas veces, y también he visto el otro lado. Y una de las cosas que me han mostrado del otro lado es precisamente una de las cámaras del Geinom. Entonces les puedo asegurar que esto existe, que no es un mito, y que es una de las tantas dimensiones que hay y de las posibilidades que tiene el Creador entre todas las cosas que él creó, como acto de bondad hacia todo este tipo de gente que está en la extrema izquierda de la maldad, ¿no? Porque para hacer todo este tipo de cosas que he descrito al principio del video, hay que realmente estar muy, muy, muy estar muy mal espiritualmente. Y bueno, entonces voy a poner a continuación este video para que lo vean. Está citando un montón de fuentes. Y decirles que sí, que no hay ninguna duda de que existe un plano en donde estos tipos de canallas, de pecadores, de gente que yerra de la forma más baja posible, donde tienen que ir a quitarse todas sus clipos. Así que bueno, les decía todo esto porque bueno, en Argentina ha desaparecido un niño y todo indica que es el tema de lo que es la trata. Por supuesto han actuado los gobiernos, desde el gobierno hasta las autoridades provinciales han actuado con una impericia terrorífica, malísima. Han perdido tiempo, no han actuado de forma rápida, han sucedido cosas para desviar la investigación y han permitido que todo eso suceda, dando a entender de que hay complicidad política, ¿no? Bueno, todo esto pasa en este mundo donde está mucha gente está completamente en la extrema izquierda del árbol de las vidas. Vamos a ver el video y sirve para reflexionar, sirve para tener muy en cuenta y con el cual estoy absolutamente de acuerdo. Shalom uberajá para todos.
The last verse of the book of Isaiah, what the prophet Isaiah saw, that not only did Isaiah see Gehenom, but he knows exactly what happens there. Chapter 66, verse 24, says, they will go out and see the corpses of the men who rebelled against Hashem, for their decay will not cease and their fire will not be extinguished and they will lie in disgrace before all mankind. And the Gemara in Masechet Shabbat, page 33b, and also the Zohar, talks about how this is the source of how for wicked people that do not do tshuva, there is an eternal Gehenom that exists. What did Isaiah actually see himself? And this is the narration. Isaiah went into Gehenom, saw it, and he went into the second house, one of the chambers in there, and he saw two people hanging by their tongues. And Isaiah said to Hashem, O revealer of secrets, reveal to me the secret behind this, meaning why are these people being punished like this? They're being hung by their tongues. He said to them, these people, they slandered other people, and that's their judgment. So then Isaiah goes to the third house, meaning another chamber, and he saw men being hung by their penises. And Isaiah says to Hashem, O revealer of secrets, reveal to me the secret behind this. Why are these people having this specific judgment? So Hashem says to him, these people leave their wives alone and fornicate with other women. So this is their judgment. So Isaiah goes to the fourth house and he saw women being hung by their chest, by their breasts. So Isaiah says to Hashem, O revealer of secrets, reveal to me the secret behind this. Why are these people getting this specific punishment? HaKadosh Baruch Hu says to him, these women reveal their hair on their heads and they tear their clothing, meaning they wear immodest clothes, and then they sit in marketplaces nursing their children so that they can get people's attention and sin with them. And this is what their judgment is. Woman walks around immodestly, she wants attention. Fourth house apparently. Isaiah goes into the fifth house and he saw a house full of smoke of all sorts of noblemen and treasurers were inside there with Pa'o, the wicked, sitting on top of them guarding the entrance to Gehenom. And Pa'o saying to all of these people, why didn't you learn from me when I was in Egypt? Pa'o still sits there and guards the entrance to Gehenom. Primary thing that a person has to have is Yirat Shamayim. And that's where the Gemara says, HaKadosh Baruch Hu only created the world for you to fear Him. If the whole world was scared of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the world would simply be Gan Eden. If just Am Yisrael was scared of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the Mashiach would arrive immediately. But the point is, Rabotai Yekirim, that's how valuable Yirat Shamayim is. Learn some of these things over and over and over again on a regular basis, once a month, once every couple of weeks, once a week if necessary, and if you have a really big Yetzirah, once a day. Until you're scared enough from Hashem that you're not going to make any voluntary sins. You're going to make sins regardless, but at least it's not going to be on purpose. It's not going to be on purpose. You're going to make unintentional sins because you don't know, or you didn't realize, or it's an accident, but at least let it not be on purpose. Don't leave your house immodest. Don't waste seed on purpose because you're watching stuff. Don't do that. Why? Because that's on purpose. But don't do any purposeful sins. Don't go to McDonald's or a non-kosher restaurant because you're really hungry. Find a kosher place or don't eat at all. Don't do any purposeful sins. And after a while, this is going to help you fall in love with a Kadosh Baruch Hu. But it's something that you need to learn enough until you understand your role in this world. That you are here to serve HaKadosh Baruch Hu. He's not here to serve you. People don't like to talk about this, but we always go to the Chachamim, we always go to the Tzadikim, we always go to the Gemarot. What do they teach? If you look at the Gemara, Masechet Rosh Hashanah, end of page 16, 16b in the beginning of 17a, mentions it twice. The righteous can have a benefit and a reward for eternity, while the wicked can have a punishment and suffering for eternity. Meaning just like a Kadosh Baruch Hu's love and reward can be eternal and unlimited, the wrath of God is also unlimited. Even after Mashiach comes, their Gehenom will not be turned off. You look at Halacha, Shulchan Aruch mentions that someone that goes against the Kadosh Baruch Hu to such an extent has no share of the world to come. No share of the world to come is just another way for our Chachamim to explain to us what does it mean, Gehenom. You look at the Baal Shem Tov, you look at his Hasidim, they mentioned it. We reviewed in one of our shiurim over 1,400 sources from Hasidut, how they talk about Gehenom. This is what Torah is. You could also look at Parashat Ki Tisa, Parashat Ki Tavo, Parashat Bechukotai, Hazinu. Look at what Rashi says about where Korach is till this day. Gehenom is not Kabbalistic. It's not something that only a few know. It's basic level Judaism that unfortunately is almost unheard of in this generation. They ask Rav Avadya, what about Gehenom? Our minag is to start teaching about Gehenom at 6 years old. If he knows that there is a place of punishment at 6 years old, you're not going to have to remind him at 60. It's already ingrained in him. Being afraid is actually part of our servitude of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. It's part of our Avodat Hashem. That's why the Gemara in Masechet Shabbat, page 31b, says HaKadosh Baruch Hu only created the world in order for you to fear Him. Why? Because if you fear Him, you will serve Him. The Ramban is using a Mishnah in Pirkei Avot, chapter 3, Mishnah number 1, says the fear of God will intensify in your heart. You work on your humility, you work on your Yirat Shamayim. The Torah says that Yirat Shamayim is the only thing that's going to save you. But just in case the system fails, the Gemara says first, in Masechet Brachot, try to grab a book of Torah. Some Gemara, some Chumash, something. Press play on one of the Shiurim. Yaron Ruven / Gehenom. Yaron Ruven Kafakela. Yo, it's one of those scary Shiurim. Press play. That doesn't work. Say, Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. Why? Remind yourself, there's a God that's watching. Sometimes it doesn't work. Chachamim say, after this Yirat Shamayim intensifies in your heart, but sometimes it doesn't work, think for a second about the day that you're gonna die. There's gonna be a day, Malach HaMavet shows up and says, you're the next customer. All of us experience this. Our neshamot are no less and 5,779 years old. We all have neshamot. There's no such thing as a baby. All of our neshamot were at Mount Sinai 3,300 years ago. The body that you have today is simply like clothing. Today you wore a suit, tomorrow you're going to wear something else. That's what the body is. So the baby is simply wearing that shell now, but in his previous carnation, in his previous life, he wore a different suit, a different body. Similar face, but not the same. Similar name, but not the same. Why did he have to come back? Because he did not complete his mission. She did not complete her mission. They made certain sins that they have to make up for, and Hashem decided to give them another chance. After they paid for part of the sins in Gehinnom, they were let out in order to come back to this world to fix the rest. Now, when a person is found guilty in his judgment, they give him over to the damaging angels who bring him to different places. The path is dark and slippery. Whoever does tshuva, instead of being beaten, they bring him directly to Gan Eden. But if he dies without tshuva, they bring him to Gehinnom instead. But before all of this is done, they also get to meet Avraham and Yitzchak. And Avraham and Yitzchak come to him and say, "My son, what have you done in this world, which you existed for all these years?" If he says, "I bought fields and vineyards and I worked on them all my days," Avraham and Yitzchak say to him, "You fool, you didn't learn from David HaMelech that the land and all of its constants are Hashem's?" As it says in Tehillim 24:2, they take him and bring in the next person who says, "I acquired gold and silver." And then Avraham and Yitzchak say to him, "You fool, didn't you learn from the prophets Leah Kesef and Leah Zahav, Neum Hashem Tzevaot?" Hashem says to the prophet Haggai, "Mine is the money, mine is the gold." But if they bring a Talmid Chacham, they bring somebody that kept Torah and Mitzvot, they bring a Tzadikah there, Avraham and Yitzchak say, "What have you done in the world that they exist?" And he said, "Oh, I follow the Torah, I taught in the Torah all the days of my life." So Avraham and Yitzchak say, "Ah, may peace come and rest upon your lying place." And Hashem himself accepts this person smilingly. This Rabotai Yekarim is one of the foundations of our Torah. A moment you're going to have a test, a big test. This is the type of stuff that hopefully you'll be reminded of and not do it. Loving Hashem is a wonderful thing to acquire, but the reality is that loving Hashem by itself is not going to stop you from sinning. It won't stop you from sinning. Being afraid will stop you from sinning. And that's why it's actually something that you see in our Sidur. Tehillim say, "Ovre be'emek habacha, ma'ayin yashetu," those who pass through the valley of tears into a wellspring. So the Gemara Masechet Bava Metzia says, what is this valley of tears? What is it? It says that's one of the chambers in Gehinnom. This Rabotai Yekarim is actually part of our mincha. Every Jew has to do it at least once a day. You start with Arvit, saying, "Hashem, we're praying because in case we sin, we don't want you to destroy us." Right in the beginning of the prayer. The point is, Rabotai, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu created the world in such a way that we operate best based on fear. You don't speed on the highway because you don't want to get a ticket, you don't want to get into an accident, you don't want to hurt somebody else, and so on and so forth. We don't take stuff that doesn't belong to us because we don't want to get caught, we don't want to be embarrassed, we don't want to hurt somebody else, and so on and so forth. We don't sit at home and do nothing instead of and go to work instead, even though we don't like work. The reality is we go to work even though we don't want to. Why? Because we don't want to be homeless, we don't want to starve to death, and so on and so forth. We don't yell at our spouse and insult them because, again, we know that if we do yell at them, we do insult them, it'll hurt the marriage, it'll hurt the relationship, it'll hurt a lot of things. Loving Hashem is fantastic. It's just not something that, first of all, everybody can acquire. Number two, you can't acquire it without fearing Hashem first anyway. And three, that by itself is not going to stop you from sinning. That love of Hashem is not by itself going to stop you from cheating on your wife. There are many guys that cheat on their wife even though they love them. There are many women that cheat on their husband even though they love them. There was a recent horrible statistic that came out of Eretz Yisrael, Hashem Yirachem, and they said that women and men are just as likely to cheat on each other now. In the past, there was a men's problem because of their physical desires. Apparently, the women have become like men. They're just as likely to cheat on each other. Wait, but they all love each other. They all said, "Oh, I loved them at first sight. I love her at first sight. Okay, so why'd you cheat on her? Oh, you know, well, you love her though, no? Yeah, I love her. Why? Because love by itself does not stop us from doing stupid things. Primary thing that a person has to have is Yirat Shamayim. And that's where the Gemara says, HaKadosh Baruch Hu only created the world for you to fear him. You have to acquire Yirat Shamayim so you don't sin. Because when you sin, you disconnect from him. When you disconnect from him, he's forced to punish you. He doesn't want to punish you, but he's forced to do it. Why? Because there has to be a reward and a punishment system in this world. If just Am Yisrael was scared of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the Mashiach would arrive immediately. Better yet, if 10 Jews, Minyan, all had Yirat Shamayim under one roof, they're all here for Hashem himself, the Gemara says Mashiach arrives on the spot. Whether we like it, whether we agree with it is irrelevant. We're not the ones running the world. If the whole world was scared of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the world would simply be Gan Eden. But the point is, Rabotai Yekirim, that's how valuable Yirat Shamayim is. If you watch these shiurim on a regular basis, you'll build a Yirat Shamayim. You'll build a foundation of fearing Hashem, at least you're not going to make any purposeful sins. This is going to help you fall in love with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Actually enjoy your life and what it really is. Learn the Torah, learn the beautiful things, learn some of the scary things and see how they are also beautiful as well. But really have a true connection to HaKadosh Baruch Hu and not just be one of these fakers that walks around as if they're a perfect tzaddik, as if they have everything good, and no matter what they do, Hashem is going to give them the Gan Eden. The beard grows by itself, doesn't make you religious. The suit doesn't make you religious. On Wall Street, I also wore suits. What makes you religious is how you act and what's inside you and what comes out of your mouth. That's what makes you religious. If you allow your eyes to look at Torah, to look at good things, that's already a great start. If you allow good things to come out of your mouth, like Divrei Torah, like compliments, like good things, honesty, that's good. If you go to places that are good, full of holiness, full of Kedusha, that's good. If you look the part, that makes you perfect. That makes you perfect person to go to Gan Eden. That's what Hashem wants. But if you don't want to do that, you want to eat McDonald's once in a while because you like the cheeseburger. You like the chicken sandwich from Burger King. You want to walk around with a shirt that's just a little bit tight so they can see exactly how your body's shaped. You want to walk around with a short skirt so everybody says, wow, you're looking good today. You're going to do a lot of those things. Then guess what? You're destroying yourself. It's like somebody that jumps off of a bridge. There's nothing you can do. You already jumped. So these shiurim, it's not necessarily something that you need to learn all day, every day. But it's something that you need to learn enough until you understand your role in this world. That you are here to serve HaKadosh Baruch Hu. He's not here to serve you. If you're tired because you don't think that you're supposed to be a servant of Hashem, that means I haven't done a good enough job yet. So now I'm going to tell you what's really going to happen. Why? Because you need to be a servant of Hashem. That's the job. That's the point of this world. That's why you exist. You exist to serve Hashem. It's not as hard as you would think, I promise you. And trust me when I tell you, even if you find it extremely difficult to be modest among all of the immodest women around you, extremely difficult not to eat taref, to eat non-kosher because you have a big appetite for non-kosher things. You're addicted to, shrimp or something, the bugs of the sea. You're addicted to the cockroaches of the ocean. Call them lobster. You're addicted to it. Trust me when I tell you, it's going to be much harder in Gehinnom. Why? Because over there they force feed you. You understand? Here, you chose. So even if it's hard for you not to waste seed, hard for you not to not touch somebody that's not your wife, hard for you not to let a man touch you when he's not your husband, hard for you to give tzedakah, hard because you love your money so much, you want it all for yourself, hard for you to fulfill the Torah, hard for you to learn, it's hard for you. Trust me when I tell you, as hard as it is in the beginning, it's not even 1% of 1% of 1% as hard as Gehinnom is for the first minute. And Gehinnom only gets more hard. So this is what we need to learn in order to have at least a foundation to get an understanding that this is what our role is in this world. And the best part about it is that once a person accepts that she's a servant of Hashem, she's a representation of Hashem, he's a representation of Hashem, he's a servant of Hashem, guess what? All of a sudden, the mitzvot become fun. Why? That's my job. If my job is to fulfill the Torah and do mitzvot, then that means that every time I did it, you're going to get some gratification out of it. Why? You did a job. You did a good job. You kept Shabbat. You're happy at the end of Shabbat. Wow, I kept the whole Shabbat by myself. You ate kosher, Baruch Hashem. Look, I ate, and I said a bracha in the beginning, and at the end. You feel a sense of achievement, believe it or not. Eating becomes significant. Why? Because it's not just you eating to just fulfill your appetite. It's even your eating becomes serving of Hashem. It's not that you're just reading and, okay, you got smarter. No, now you're reading Torah. You're actually learning about HaKadosh Baruch Hu. You're learning more things to do. How to serve Him even better. Your reading becomes significant. It's not that you just walk down the street and it's just like everybody else, you go to the store. No, during that walk to the street, you watch your eyes. Everything that's immodest, you look away. So even you walking to the store, to the deli, to the supermarket, to the laundromat, becomes a mission for HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Why? I didn't look. I didn't look where I don't belong. Going outside as a Bat Yisrael, you are a walking Kiddush Hashem. Why? Everybody's looking at you. Instead of looking at all the immodest women, they're looking at the one modest one. And everybody else is naked. This is the only one that looks like a queen. You're a walking Kiddush Hashem. Everyone wants to marry the princess. You walk around as a modest woman, you are sanctifying a Kadosh Baruch Hu's name simply by existing. A married woman walking around with a kisui rosh, a hat or a scarf on her head, the opposite of everybody else. It's even more significant in this generation. But then, Rabotai Yekarim, if a person doesn't do anything that the Torah here says, then just know, the Zohar Kadosh says that for every single body part they sin, one of the things that they will experience in Chibut HaKever, in the grave, is that there will be a spiritual snake coming out of every single hole and every single part of their body that sin. If they sin with their brit, there's going to be a spiritual snake there constantly torturing them in that area. If she walked around without kisui rosh, all of our hair is going to turn into snakes like Medusa. I'm not even giving you 1% of what it says, and it's already scaring me, and I'm telling you. It's not worth it. As hard as doing tshuva is, trust me, it's much, much easier than the consequence of not doing tshuva. Because all of us at some point leave this world. Be'ezrat Hashem, it's after all of us do tshuva, regardless of the age. Who cares about the age as long as you did tshuva? It doesn't matter when you die. It matters if you did tshuva before you died. If you did tshuva, then you go in a great, fantastic place for eternity. What difference does it make that you're leaving this world at 30, at 40, at 90, at 100? Who cares? You're going to an eternal place of good. Yeah, the people behind you, they're sad because you're not around anymore and so on. But yeah, but if they really know that you're a tzaddik, you're a tzaddikah, you're going to Gan Eden, they're happy when you die. Why? He's going to eternity. He's going to eternity of good. Who cares when you die as long as you did tshuva first? But if you died without doing tshuva, Hashem Yerachem, even if you died at 120, it actually makes the case worse. Why? You made more sins. Made more judgment. So instead of thinking, when you look at people, instead of saying happy birthday to people and thinking, oh, hopefully he lasts a long time, hopefully she lasts a long time, no, hopefully they do tshuva. That should be your prayer for yourself, your prayer for everybody else. That's the number one thing. Why? Because if a person does tshuva, they connect to HaKadosh Baruch Hu while they're alive, they're assured to have an eternity of good. And that's the best thing that you could ever give somebody. What do you think? Hashem is not going to give you even more money so you can help even more people when you're helping all of his kids come home? Help people do tshuva. Tshuva means that you help somebody change their life. Their lifestyle, the way they look at the world, their perspective of the world, what they're going to do in this world, they change their life.
Suscríbete, hacete miembro, compartí el canal y ayúdanos con tu Sedaká. Está nuestro PayPal ahí en la información. Si querés clases de Kabbalah, me escribís a psignosis7@gmail.com. Shalom uberajá para todos.